My name is Sophie Rose. I'm 22 years old, and I have volunteered to be infected with COVID-19.
Why would anyone want to be infected with a disease that's gotten millions of people sick and killed hundreds of thousands?
Hey guys, I'm Guillory, and this is the second month of working from home because of the COVID-19 shutdowns. Even though world leaders keep hinting that a coronavirus vaccine could be ready in record time, scientists are warning they're being too optimistic. To speed up that process, Sophie wants to take part in what's called a challenge trial. Volunteers get the potential vaccine and then are deliberately infected with the coronavirus. Scientists then see if the vaccine is effective. It's a quicker but more dangerous way to test how viable a vaccine might be. Is there a risk of death in participating in something like this?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. And I think the answer to that is yes. I pulled some numbers on this because I think numbers are compelling to me at least. But when we look at data that's coming out of China, the death rate for people my age was between 1 in 3,000. I guess an important comparison here is when you look at the death rate of something like childbirth in the US, that's 1 in 6,500. And the risk of kidney donation is 1 in 3,000. So it's somewhat on a par with other situations that people might find themselves in.
So does that mean that you're injected with the coronavirus?
When human challenge trials have been conducted in the past, participants have been exposed to different diseases by a nasal spray, or in some situations by ingesting a solution containing the pathogen. So that was for cholera. When I read about that, I was kind of like, oh, how would I feel about drinking something that I knew had cholera in it? I would expect, given that it is a respiratory disease, that it would likely be via nasal spray though.
This all sounds extreme, but let's back up and look at why it takes so long to produce a vaccine in the first place. After scientists come up with a potential vaccine, they test its safety on a few volunteers. If successful, they scale up to phase two, testing how the vaccine affects the immune system of a few hundred volunteers and what side effects it might cause. Phase three takes the longest. Thousands of volunteers are involved, and scientists test to see if the vaccine can be scaled up.
How much time are we talking about shaving off the process?
We don't know how fast it would make it, but it seems reasonable to say that if it could even save like a small amount of time, it could be worth it.
When Sophie says it could be worth it, she's talking about the potential damage to her body if the vaccine doesn't work. For this case, volunteers have to be young, healthy, and have no pre-existing health conditions. So far, no regulatory body is allowing human challenge trials in the search for a COVID-19 vaccine.
But the group Sophie is part of, One Day Sooner, is hoping to show authorities that there are enough volunteers to make these trials viable. By mid-May, they say they had recruited more than 20,000 people from over 100 countries. Human challenge trials have been carried out in the past, sometimes leading to important medical developments, like the discovery of the smallpox vaccine. But they put test subjects at great risk. That's why they're generally avoided today. But even if these trials get the green light and volunteers like Sophie help the world find a vaccine faster, the vaccine development process still faces a lot of other challenges.
I do not think we're going to have a vaccine in 12 months that can be distributed everywhere around the world.
I spoke to Dr. Maria Botazzi, who worked on a vaccine for a previous strain of the coronavirus, the one that caused the SARS epidemic. Like several other labs, her team got pretty far in development, but their federal funding dried up when SARS was no longer considered a priority. Without money to continue, Dr. Botazzi and her team had to freeze their work, literally.
Are there similarities between the strain that you were looking at in 2010 and what we're facing now?
The two viruses, SARS and SARS-2, are genetically very similar. We know they both use the same receptor to infect the cells. So their spike protein is, you know, of course, very similar. And more importantly, the receptor binding domain, which is the basis of our vaccine, it's, you know, almost greater than 80% similar.
Many say if research teams like Dr. Batazzi's had been given the funding they needed to complete their testing, the world wouldn't be scrambling like it is right now to find a vaccine. Some scientists are estimating we could have shaven a year off the projected timeline to find a COVID-19 vaccine.
Sad to see how, when there's been already so much investment in some programs, that then you just stop them. Then all of a sudden it's like, oh shoot, didn't we have something like 5 years ago? Let's figure out how we can, you know, revive them.
The for-profit sector has also come up short here. Most large pharmaceutical companies have actually abandoned developing vaccines.
Medicines that treat chronic conditions, like arthritis, diabetes, even erectile dysfunction, are just more profitable. They're usually marketed at richer patients, and unlike vaccines, they're taken over and over again.
But with dozens of labs and corporations all around the world working at the same time to find a potential vaccine for COVID-19, Dr. Botazzi sees a chance to change how things work.
I think it's actually quite unprecedented that all of a sudden you have so many groups attempting to develop a vaccine. I am hoping that all of them also have in the back of their minds that at the same time is not only to develop a safe, effective, and immunogenic vaccine, but that it will be affordable and that it can be usable around the world.
That doesn't just mean a massive effort to manufacture enough of it, which is a challenge by itself, but also making sure that people have access to it, no matter which country they're in or how rich they are.
Generally, those who make vaccines tend to be in these large economies, and after they protect their own, you know, who's going to protect everybody else?
One country that does produce a lot of affordable medicines is India. But for years, the US, EU, and others have pressured India to protect the profits of foreign pharmaceuticals by cutting down the production of generics.
What's clear now is that we need more global cooperation and long-term scientific funding so that next time around, people like Sophie don't need to put themselves in harm's way to beat the virus.
What I would love to have come out of a human challenge trial happening if I were to participate in one is to see a vaccine distributed to the general public, to everybody in society, on a faster timeline than it would have been otherwise. I would love for us to be in a situation where people start to be able to bring about a little bit more normalcy into their lives, I guess.